بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear medical students, my greetings. My name is Wadie Muhammad Yasin, and this is my email. If you would like to contact with me, I'm happy to respond to your questions and suggestions. This is the first lecture among a series of lectures concerning the renal pathology for medical students, or diseases of the kidney in other words. I'm going to tackle the kidney pathology or kidney diseases in a series of lectures, maybe 8 or something like this. So this is the first lecture. And in kidney diseases, you have to be acquainted with the pictures. The pictures are very important to understand the kidney diseases. Whenever you see a picture in the chapter of renal pathology, just take time and look at the pictures in the chapter. You are going to understand a lot, because renal pathology is not an easy part of disease. It is a tough course and it needs concentration. Therefore, as it is said, a picture is worth 1,000 words. The presentation outlines of my talk, I'm going to touch the following points. Number one, the intended learning outcomes. What do I want you to know from this presentation? And I'm trying to do this in all my presentations. The first thing is that you have to know, what do I want you to know from my presentation? So you have to focus on this, because at the end of any presentation, you find some questions to check your understanding of the intended learning outcomes. The second outline of this presentation is that I'm going to talk a bit little about the normal structure of the kidney. This includes the normal histology, the gross anatomy, and the embryology. Without understanding these structures, you may not understand the pathology, because as you all know, pathology is deviation from normal in structure and function. So if you do not know what is normal, what is the normal anatomy, what is the normal histology, you are not going to determine diseases. The third part of my presentation, I'm going to talk about physiology of the kidney. What are the functions of the kidney? What do they really do in our body, so that you can know what happens if things went wrong? Because it is very important. Understanding the normal functions will make you understand what is going to happen if these functions are jeopardized. The fourth point of my talk will be about classification of kidney diseases or renal disease. How do we classify these diseases? And it means that by classification, we usually try to simplify things, because if you put things in groups, this will facilitate understanding. Therefore, you have to know, how do we classify renal diseases? The fifth point of my talk, I'm going to start my talk about glomerular diseases. And as you know, glomeruli are the very important parts of the nephron. The nephron is composed of glomerulus and tubules, but the most important part is the glomerular part. Therefore, in the first talk, I'm going to tell you about glomerular disease in brief. In the second lecture, I'm going to talk a bit little more about the glomerular diseases. And at the end of my talk, you will find a quiz section in which I'm going to post some questions that you have to answer, if to check that you understood what I have been talking about. And definitely, there is more knowledge that I can give you here in this brief talk. Therefore, there are further sources for learning, and I usually advise my students to go through our book, The Basic Pathology of Robins. This is very important for all medical students all around the world. You have to go through Robins' Basic Pathology. So, what are the intended learning outcomes? By the end of this session, I expect you to identify the embryology of the kidney, to tell me what is the source of the kidney, where does it come from. And number two, to describe the normal structures of the kidney. What are they in the kidney? Grossly, histologically, and under electron microscope. You have to know the three parts: the gross pathology, the histological, and the electron microscopic feature. My third learning outcome is that I would like you to classify the diseases of the kidney in a scientific way. So after classification of scientific disease, you can say this group is so and so, and this group is so and so, and characterized by so and so. In the fourth part of the intended learning outcome is that I expect you to be able to explain the most commonly used terminology of glomerular diseases. We all know that in any science there is terminology, many terms that you have to put in mind. For example, in skin pathology, you have to know many terms. In renal pathology, you have to know many terms. In CNS pathology, you have to know many terms. This is very important that you know the language by which we talk. The fifth point of my objective of this session is that by the end of this session, you should be able to explain the pathogenesis of glomerular disease. How do they occur? This is the pathogenesis. Why do they occur, and how do they occur in a chronological or in a time sequence? The sixth learning outcome, I would like you to relate the symptoms and signs of renal disease to kidney structure and function. So whenever you see edema in a renal patient or renal disease patient, you can say why is this. When you see increased level of urea, you can tell why is this. The seventh learning outcome is that you should be able to justify the derangements or abnormalities that occur in the body when there is renal pathology. So you can anticipate why anemia occurs in patients with renal pathology. You have to know this and the other things. Number eight, I would like to make my students appreciate the importance of the normal kidney in homeostasis, that is to say the internal body equilibrium, or the milieu, the interior milieu, as we say it. You have to appreciate the importance of the normal kidney in the homeostasis, and this is a behavioral objective. You can see these are my intended learning outcomes I would like you to master. Okay, it is very important. Some of them are cognitive, that is to say knowledge. Most of them are knowledge. Few are skills, one or two, and then there is a behavioral, number eight is a behavioral objective. So these are the nice kidneys as you can see them, and in the animation on your left hand you see that there is blood that comes to the kidney, and there are excretions from this kidney, and on the right side you can see the basic structures of these very nice structures, and connected to an artery, red in color, a vein, blue in color, and a ureter, that is yellowish in color. In the embryology of the kidney, you have to know that there are primitive structures. As you can see in the upper part near the cervical region, it starts the kidney. The kidney starts as a poronephric system, and then it degenerates or disappears, the poronephric system. And the segmented intermediate mesoderm. You have to know that the kidney and the urinary tract arises from the mesoderm. Therefore, you can see the poronephric system that degenerates. And then there will be the mesonephros and the mesonephric ducts that later form the kidney. And these are the primitive structures, as you can see at your left hand. There is a poronephric duct that forms the peronephros, and that disappears in the second picture in the middle, as you can see, degenerating peronephros, and then appears the mesonephros, and finally you find the mesonephric and the mesonephric blastema that form the kidney. Therefore, you can say that the glomeruli may arise from part, and then comes the collecting ducts and the other parts of the kidney from the lower part. The kidneys are bean-shaped, reddish-brown structures. They are located retroperitoneally between T12 and L3 vertebral level. The approximate size of the kidney is 10 centimeters, and it is long from pole to pole, from the upper to lower, 6.5 centimeters from the width, and the narrowest part is 3 centimeters. Therefore, it is 10 by 6.5 by 3 centimeters approximately. The kidney weighs around 135 to 150 grams. That is mean both kidneys are, when they weigh less than 300 grams, very small amount, less than 1/3 of a kilogram. However, they are highly vascular organs. Both kidneys are very vascular, and therefore each kidney receives 25% of the cardiac output. You can see that this is very small structure, that is about 150 grams, but it receives 1/4 of the cardiac output comes to the kidney. Not because the kidney uses it, but because the kidney has something to do concerning the filtration and the clearing of the blood. The kidney produces urine. This is the most important function of the kidney, which is an ultrafiltrate of blood, which is then modified by selective resorption and specific secretion by cells of the kidney. Therefore, the most important component that the kidney produces is the urine. After many processes, it is very important. The blood supply to the kidney, we know that 90 to 95% of blood passing through kidneys is in the cortex. This is very important to have to know that the cortex is very rich in blood. However, the medulla receives less blood, 5 to 10% is in the medulla. What is the importance of such an information? You can anticipate in case of ischemia, the medullary structures, that is to say the tubules, you expect them to be affected more than the cortical structures, which are the glomeruli. Therefore, later on, we are going to see acute tubular necrosis. Whenever there is ischemia, you can see there is necrosis of the tubules rather than necrosis of the glomeruli, because the glomeruli are rich in blood supply in comparison to the tubules that lie in the medulla. So you have to be acquainted with the structures of the kidney. You have to see many pictures, particularly in the kidney. So in the gross anatomy, as you all know, this we call this part what? We call it the cortex. And then we call the inner part the medulla. And this part we call it what? The renal pelvis. Yes, right. The renal pelvis. And then you have to see these blood vessels. So the basic structures are the cortex. This is the outer. This is the outer part. And then you have the renal medulla here, and then you can see the renal pelvis in this area, and then these are the blood vessels. So this is a very nice and very important picture that you have to know and to learn by heart. I'm not going to give you it for really, you have to pay something, okay? And this something is that you have to try to answer what is this structure, and what is that number two, and what is this number three, and what is this part number four, and what is this part number five, and then what is this number six, what is this, and then you have to say what is number seven, and so on. You have to try to answer what is number eight, okay, and what is this number nine. What do you call this? Okay, and what is this number 10? Okay, what is this number 11? Okay, what is this number 13? And what do we call this part number 14? Would you name it? Yes, say it loudly. I'm going to hear you. And what is this number 15? These are very important structures that you have to know in this nice kidney, healthy kidney that you see it glistening. You see the kidney is a glistening structure. So if we come to these structures one again, you can tell what is number one. Okay, this is number one, it is renal vein. What is number two? It is renal artery. What is number three? It is the calyces, the renal calyces. And what is this number four? This and this part. What is this number four? This is the medullary pyramid. We call it the pyramid. This is the medullary pyramid. A pyramid, another pyramid, another pyramid, and this is the pyramid. Okay. And what do we call number five? It is the renal cortex that we already mentioned before. This is the cortex number five. Okay, this is number five. Okay, and now can you say what is this number six? How would you name this structure number six? It is a segmental artery. It is a segmental artery. And now we come to another part. This is number seven. What is it? It is the interlobar artery, the interlobar artery. Okay, this is number seven. And now we come to this number eight. What is it? How do you call it? Yes, it is the arcuate artery or the interlobular artery. The arcuate or the interlobular artery. Okay. And now we come to this structure which is labeled number nine. What is it? It is the arcuate vein, similar to the arcuate artery. And I can't believe, usually veins come with arteries, okay? They are adjacent to each other. Here for illustration, you see here a vein and here an artery. However, there is an artery going beside the vein. And now we come to number 10. This is the interlobar vein. The interlobar vein. So, can you tell me what is number 11? Number 11 is the segmental vein. Segmental vein. And can you see number 12 here? This is number 12. What is this area? It is the renal column. We call this area the renal column that lies between the pyramids. These are the pyramids, and between them you can see the renal column. And number 13, this part, what do we call it? We call it the renal papillae. Therefore, you are going to hear something called papillary necrosis, renal papillary necrosis. All right? So this is the renal papillae. And now we come to the easy parts. What do we call number 14? It is the renal pelvis. Yes, of course, you know it. And what is this easy one? You have to know it. What is it? It is the ureter. Okay? So these are the very important structures that you have to know by heart, from 1, 2, 3, 4, and you have to know them all, because all pathology of the kidney occurs in these structures. We are not going to go outside these structures that you have to know. Okay? All right. Now we move forward. This is another picture of the kidney or demonstration. It's actually drawing where you can see the glomerulus connected to tubules. You have to know the different parts and study them by yourself. You have to know this is an afferent artery, and this is an efferent artery, and then they form the interlobular capillary, and then these capillaries, and then starting the venous system. We know that this is the glomerular capsule, and this is the neck of the nephron, and these are the tubules. All know the spiral tubule, the descending lobe of Henle, and the ascending lobe of Henle, and then the other parts of the collecting ducts and so on that lead to the ureter. You have to know all this. And also I would like you to notice this demarcation. This part usually lies in the cortical substance that we saw, the cortex. So this is the cortex, and then we see a boundary zone that separates the cortex from the medulla, and then you can see the medullary substance in which you find some tubules. All right, therefore this is the cortex, and these are the structures in the cortex. You have to know them one by one. It is not my responsibility to teach you every bit of detail. And this is the boundary zone between the cortical substance and the medullary substance. You have to know the glomerulus. This is the glomerulus. Simply, there is an arteriole going in, as you see this arrow, and then this arteriole divides into many small arteries, and then it collects again to form another arteriole. You see an arteriole going into an organ and then getting out as an arteriole. This you cannot see except in the liver. Okay? In any other organ in the body, what you see is that an artery goes in and emerging out as a vein. But here you see an artery, that is the afferent arteriole. It divides into many parts and then reunite again to form the efferent arteriole. This is very unique for the glomerulus. An artery goes in, an artery goes out. In any other structure of the body, you see an artery going in and a vein going out. However, in the glomerulus, this is not the case. So in this picture, You can see this is the capsule of the glomerular, and this you can see the afferent arteriole. Okay, the afferent arteriole comes, and you can see the granular cells of the gastroglomerular apparatus. You can see them here in the afferent, and a few in the efferent, in the efferent arteriole. And artery goes and divides into many parts, okay, and then leaves as an arteriole also, okay. This area, as you all know, is the macula densa cells of the gastroglomerular apparatus, okay. So this is the macula densa cells of the gastroglomerular apparatus, and these are the granular cells of the gastroglomerular apparatus. And this here you can see the tubule. The tubule, this is the neck, and this is the tubule, the first part of the proximal tubule. This illustration is very important. As we all know, an artery comes in, divides into many arterioles, and then leaves out. And then leaves out as an arteriole, as we mentioned before. Okay, now when we come to take this section of this part of the glomerulus, we can see the first outer layer is the parietal epithelium or parietal epithelial cells. This is the nucleus of the cell, and this is the cytoplasmic part of the cell. Okay, so this is the parietal epithelium. The first layer is the parietal epithelium, and there is a space here beneath the parietal epithelium. This is the urinary space where urine is formed. All right, now we come to this layer. You have to see this layer. Okay, this layer with the blue color demonstrates the food processes. These are the food processes of the podocyte. This is a podocyte. A podocyte means a cell that has food processes. Podocyte. This podocyte is the visceral epithelium or the visceral epithelial cell. Therefore, you can imagine that you have parietal epithelium, and then you have urinary space here, and then you have the visceral epithelial cell that attaches to the basement membrane through these food processes. All these are food processes of parietal epithelial cells. As you can imagine, the cells are removed from these parts, and this is one cell, and there is another cell here, another cell, and these are the food processes of each of these cell. Okay, and now we come, these food processes are attached to a basement membrane. This is the basement membrane. As you can see, the food processes are attached to the basement membrane. This is a very important part, the basement membrane. Okay, this color, okay, brownish color. And then comes the inner layer of the basement membrane. You can see it is attached to the endothelial cell. This is an endothelium. This is endothelial cell. This is the nucleus of the endothelial cell. This is the cytoplasmic part of the endothelial cell. And in the kidney, you see the endothelial cells are fenestrated, or they are small windows or small slits in the cytoplasm of the endothelial cell. This is another endothelial cell. This is endothelial cell. Okay, and this is endothelial cell. And you can see the red blood cells. Okay, so this is the urinary, this is the capillary lumen. Okay, this is the capillary lumen. Okay, as you can see here, this is the capillary lumen. Now we have two spaces, the capillary lumen and the urinary lumen. In the center of the glomerulus, you can see these cells, and these are mesangial cells. The mesangial cells, they are very important for supporting the structure. They keep these structures into place. Okay, in between these mesangial cells, you can see this greenish material that is known as the mesangial matrix. Okay, this is very important histology and very important structures of the glomerulus that you have to know. Without knowing this structure, you are not going to understand the further talk of my presentation. You have to know that if you have a glomerulus, you have an artery coming in, dividing into many, many blood vessels. These are the blood vessels, as you can see, into small spaces, and then it comes out as an efferent arteriole. However, you have to know that there is a parietal epithelium surrounding the whole structures. It is a circle, and beneath it there is a urinary space, and then to the inner layer we find food processes of visceral epithelial cells. And then we have this basement membrane that is very important. This is the basement membrane, dark in color, a bit little dark, as you can notice. This is the basement membrane, and in the innermost part you can see the endothelial cell is in a circular shape, and it has fenestrations. It has fenestrations, fenestri in the endothelial cell. Therefore, you can expect that the blood comes inside these small lumens, and there is filtration of certain substances and water to the urinary space, and this filtrate then goes to the proximal tubule. Okay, where reabsorption occurs and further processes occur. Alright, therefore, if you can imagine, this is a red blood cell. A red blood cell should not pass to the urinary space, isn't it? This red blood cell should not pass to the urinary space. Even larger proteins should not pass to the urinary space. This is the basic structure of the kidney. It is very important, and you have to learn by heart and go through it simply and repeat my words again and repeat the video to check that you understood what I'm talking about. Here is the real life picture, and this is the histology. This is the histology. You do not see as nice as the previous illustration, but we can know that these are tubules, or these are tubules. These are tubular nuclei. These are nuclei of the cell. This is the cell, and this is nucleus, and another cell, which is nucleus, and these small things are nuclei. Okay, all right. And here you can see the glomerulus. These are the glomerulus cells containing mesangial cells and visceral and parietal epithelial cells. It was not as demonstrated in the demonstration in the previous photo. Okay, but this is the histology that we can see under the microscope. And then you can see these are the blood vessels. These are the blood vessels in the kidney. When we make it larger, we go through the electron microscope, the scanning electron microscope, and the transmission electron microscope. In the scanning electron microscope, you can see the capillary tuff or the glomerulus. So you can see there is an artery going in and divides, and then it leaves out. Okay, these are the proliferation of the arteries. Okay, when we come to see through the transmission electron microscope, we can see these are the structures. This is the outer layer that we talk about as podocyte. We call it a podocyte. Okay, podocyte. And these small structures, what are they? They are the food processes. All these are food processes through which a podocyte attaches to the basement membrane. And then we can see the basement membrane or the basal lamina. This is the basement membrane. Okay, all this is the basement membrane. And then we come to the endothelial cell. This is the endothelial cell, and this is the capillary lumen. This is the glomerular capillary lumen where RBCs and blood passes. Okay, this is the nucleus of the endothelial cell. These things that looks like a shark or a large fish is the nucleus of the endothelial and you can see these small slits or windows. These are the fenestrations. These are very important for the glomerular filtrate. So if we took this part, this square, and we make it larger, we can see the structures. We can see the food processes of the podocytes. These are the podocytes. This is the food processes, and this is the basement membrane. This part is the basement membrane, and here you can see the endothelial cell pores or fenestrations. These are the, this is the endothelial cell, this is the endothelial cell, and there are fenestrations or openings or slits. Another larger photo for the glomerulus between the afferent or the coming in arteriole and the artery that leaves the glomerulus. This is the